Good morning. Today we are going over our energy homework, and this covers enthalpy, entropy, and free energy. So let's get started. The first question asks, what process or reaction releases heat to the surroundings? So heat is our enthalpy, and we've got endothermic or exothermic. Endothermic is when I'm absorbing heat from the surroundings, and exothermic is when I'm releasing. So if I'm releasing heat, they want exothermic. Next, based on this reaction shown, which statement is true? It's important to note that the delta H shown applies to this reaction exactly as written. So what this is saying then is for every 1 mole of N2, and for every 1 mole of O2, and for every 2 moles of NO, I have this many kilocalories of heat, which this is positive, so that must be absorbed, right? So if I have N2, let's make this bigger, plus O2 goes to form 2NO, delta H, 43.2 kcals, then this applies directly to the stoichiometric relationship given 1, 1, and 2. Or in other words, 1 and 2 would give me, or would require, 43.2 kcals to react. Same thing with 1, O2 would require 43.2 kcals to react. And if I formed 2 NOs, that would require 43.2 kcals. So we're using those coefficients there. So let's see, 43.2 consumed if 1 gram of nitrogen reacts? Nope, it would have to be a mole of nitrogen. So that's definitely not true. Same with the second one, 1 gram? Nope, this is good for 1 mole, so molar ratio. This much is consumed if 1 gram of NO is produced? No, that much is consumed if 2 moles of NO is produced. Let's see. 43.2 kcals consumed when 1 mole of O2 reacts. That's exactly what this is saying. 1 mole of O2 reacts, that's the amount of energy consumed, so that's it. And 43.2 kcals produced when 1 mole is produced. Nope, it would have to be 2 moles. So, and in addition to that, this would be consumed because this is a endothermic reaction as written. So this is definitely the answer they're looking for. All right, how much heat is absorbed during the production of 111 grams of NO? So this combines what we've got for stoichiometry with what we're learning for heat. So what we learned from this reaction as written is that for every 2 moles of NO, we get, or we consume, 43 kcals. All right, so if I'm producing 111 grams of NO, since this is moles, I'm going to have to convert from grams to moles. Nitrogen is 14.01, oxygen is 16, so that gives us a total of 30.01 grams per mole. You don't have to have those memorized. Of course, you'll have periodic table. And the grams go on the bottom so that they will cancel. Moles on top. Next, we know that 2 moles of NO require 43 kcals of heat. So our moles of NO will cancel. And if I do my math, that'll tell me how many kilocalories will be absorbed. So 111 grams divided by 30.01 grams per mole multiplied by 43 kcals per mole gives me 159 kcals, or 160 around. Let's plug that in again, see if I missed something. I forgot to divide by 2 moles of NO at the end. So that's 79.5, or 80 kcals. There we go. Good enough. Next, same kind of story. They want to know how much heat is evolved or absorbed in the reaction when 2.83 grams of sodium react with water. They give us the equation, they give us the delta H. So we're going to plug this in. So starting with what they give us here, we have 2.83 grams sodium. According to the periodic table, sodium weighs 22.98 grams, 1 mole. And we can see, as this equation is written, 2 moles of sodium releases 88 kcals of heat. So 2 moles of sodium on the bottom, 88 kcals on the top. Now, do I need to put the negative sign? No, the negative sign just tells me that it's being released. So I can remember that whatever this answer is, that's the amount of heat being released. I don't have to include that negative sign. So 2.83 divided by 22.98 multiplied by 88 kcals per 2 moles gives me 5.41 kcals of heat. And that is exothermic because the delta H is negative. Next, in the process of dissolving sugar in water, the entropy increases. That means the sign of delta S is positive. Positive means entropy increases and the randomness of the system increases. So knowing what those signs are and what those mean, that's an important part of this chapter. Next, we're asked if entropy increases or decreases in the following processes. So in the first place, if I have complex carbohydrates being converted to simple sugars, hopefully you can see I'm going from something that's more complex to something that's more simple. So that increases entropy, increases randomness and disorder, because I'm moving from complex things to simple things. If steam condenses on a glass surface, that's a gas which is being converted to a liquid. That's condensation, gas to a liquid. And hopefully you recognize that gases have more disorder and randomness than liquids do. So that would be a decrease in entropy because I'm going from a more random state, that is a gas, to a less random state, which is a liquid. Finally here, I've got magnesium plus chlorine goes to form magnesium chloride. And hopefully you can see I've got 2 molecules going to form 1 molecule. So I'm increasing in order in that respect. Also, I have a solid and a gas going to form just a solid. So that is also a sign that you're moving towards a more ordered system. So that would be a decrease in disorder, a decrease in entropy. All right, spontaneous is looking at delta G. And what that means is that a process begins or the reaction begins and then it continues without any external influence. It might need external influence just to get started, but after it gets started, it just keeps going. And so that is this one here, right? This is talking about having a positive delta S. This is talking about being in equilibrium, which we'll talk about later in this chapter. This is talking about delta H. So we're looking at proceeding once it has begun. Okay, what is going on here? This problem is simpler than it might appear at start. If we've got the red molecules are A2, that's 2 A atoms, and the B molecules are B2, that's 2 B atoms. We could describe what's going on here. It looks like I've got 4 A2s and 4 B2s. Okay, so 4 A2. Plus 4 B2. And that goes to form. In our product, it looks like I have two A's and one B. And I have four of those. So I have four molecules that have this formula of having two A's and one B. And I also have two of these B2 molecules. Okay, that's what I actually see going from the left-hand box to the right-hand box. Now I'm not done, because if I look at this carefully, and if I look at this carefully, I see that I can reduce it. I have B2 on both sides. It appears, oh, there were two B2s. It appears that two of these B2s didn't react, right? I had four, now I have two. So two of these were actually not involved in the reaction. So I can simplify this reaction by showing, appropriately saying, that I had four A2s and they only reacted with two of the B2s. And that's what gave me four A2Bs. And these were like spectators. They're not actually reacting. So they're not part of the reaction I would draw. And so this is what actually is reacting. And once I'm done here, I hope you can see we can reduce it, because the balanced equation is the lowest whole number ratio. So for every two A2s, I have one B2 that reacts and I get two A2Bs. What is the sign for delta G? If we read this carefully, it tells us it was spontaneous. There's no other way I would know. So because it's spontaneous, delta G must be negative. That's what it means to be spontaneous. What is the sign for delta S? Hopefully you can see I'm going from more molecules to fewer molecules. So that looks like I'm creating more order. So that would be a negative delta S. And what is the delta H for the reaction? That's a good question. They didn't give us any information here about heat being released. And there's no information here about heat being released. But what we know, because the reaction is spontaneous or favorable, but the entropy is creating more order or it's unfavorable. The only reason that this would ever go forward or be spontaneous is if the delta H could be favorable to make up for the unfavorability of the delta S. So the delta H has to be less than zero in order to overcome that. So this is a case where it might give you a little bit of information, you can deduce a little bit of information, and then you can apply that, what you know, to the equation to understand what this last little piece is going to be. All right, what two factors affect the spontaneity of the reaction? Well, spontaneity is delta G. And so what we get is that equation, which you don't have to memorize. I'll give it to you. Delta H minus T delta S. You'll never have to do math with it either. It's just a logic of understanding the pluses and the minuses. So the two factors that explain the spontaneity of the reaction, this is spontaneity. Then what you're looking at is enthalpy and entropy. So release or absorption of heat, that is enthalpy. Increase or decrease in entropy, that's delta S. So it's delta H and delta S here. The phase of the reactions, nope. Quantity of reagents, nope. Volume, nope. Time available, nope. You could also argue that temperature is a factor, but they didn't include that here, so we won't worry about that one. All right, next, energy diagram for a reaction that is slightly unfavorable. So this is delta G, free energy here on the y-axis, and then as the reaction proceeds on the x-axis. And if it's unfavorable, then the delta G is positive. That's the difference between the reactants and the products. So if it goes up, then that would be positive. Up, that's positive. This goes down a little bit, that goes down a lot. So these would be negative delta G's. Those would be exergonic, spontaneous. These would be positive delta G's. This would be non-spontaneous or endergonic. And they want the one that is slightly unfavorable. So a very small difference in delta G. This is a very large difference in delta G. So they want this energy diagram. All right, finally we've got a reaction where solid A decomposes to form solid B and gaseous C. Okay, and the delta H is negative 23.5 kcals per mole. Sine of delta S, it looks like I'm going from more order to more disorder because I have a lot more atoms or molecules here than I do here. And everything's solid here and I have gases here and those are highly disordered. So my delta S would definitely be greater than zero. It would be positive because it is going towards more disorder. Next, is the reaction likely to be spontaneous, non-spontaneous, or what? Well, if we know here, this tells us that the delta H is negative. They said that. And we know here, we just deduced that the delta S is positive. So since the temperature always has to be positive, since it's always given in Kelvin, positive times a positive is a positive. And if I'm subtracting a positive value, then I'm becoming more negative. If I start with something that's negative and I become more negative, then this will just always be negative. So that would be spontaneous at all temperatures. Last question. How would we interpret these reaction diagrams? Reaction A looks like delta G is going down. So it is negative. So it is exergonic or spontaneous. So we're looking at either this option, or this option. It is exergonic. How fast does it occur with respect to reaction B? Well, reaction B is endergonic because I have a positive delta G, but I do have a slightly smaller activation energy for the reaction B than I do for reaction A. So this might be spontaneous, but it takes a lot longer because I have to get over that big hill. So I'm going to say that it's exergonic, but it's going to be a little bit slower than reaction B. It's going to be first option there. Okay, that was it. This particular homework assignment doesn't have a ton of math. It's mostly conceptual. Should be pretty quick for you. I hope that was helpful.